Hey everyone, welcome to homeschool. So we are in the last part of the second chapter, that is biological classification. We have completed three kingdoms, that is kingdom Monera, kingdom Protista and kingdom Fungi. So we are supposed to start with the kingdom Plantae and Animalia. So kingdom Plantae and Animalia, we will be studying it in separate chapters only. There we will go in very detail, so there is no need of actually studying it here, but still, since it is there in the chapter, we will study few very important basic points of it. We will just quickly see what exactly characteristics fall under the Plantae and Animalia. In detail, each and every part of Plantae and Animalia, we have separate chapter, that is chapter 3 and chapter 4, there we'll study it. Okay, so firstly, kingdom Plantae. So Plantae, everyone have seen. So once we call it as plants, what comes to your picture? Usually green color, beautiful plants will, or nature comes to your picture. So what are the characteristics? They are eukaryotic. Firstly, they are eukaryotic. Very important and very well-known characteristic is they are photosynthetic. They are photosynthetic. And what is responsible or what is helping the photosynthesis in the plants? It is the presence of chlorophyll pigment. Okay, it is the presence of the chlorophyll pigment. See, I said the plants are photosynthetic in nature, but there are few exceptions in the plants also. A few are heterotrophs and a few are parasitic in nature. We will just see one example each for the heterotroph and parasitic. So heterotroph. Heterotrophs are, that is, usually the insectivorous plants are heterotrophs in nature. A good example for that is the Venus flytrap plant. Venus flytrap plant is the insectivorous plant, which is an example for heterotroph. Then for the parasite, parasitic, the example is cuscuta. Example is cuscuta. Anyways, each and everything in detail, we'll be studying it in the next chapter, that is Plantae itself. Okay. Then what are the groups which are there in the kingdom Plantae and which we are going to study in the next chapter is algae, bryophyta, pteridophyta, angiosperms and gymnosperms. And gymnosperms. These are the groups which are there in the kingdom Plantae, and we will be studying each group in detail in the next chapter. Fine. Then coming to the life cycle. So life cycle mainly has two parts. Life cycle of a plant has two parts. The first part is the diploid sporophytic. First one is diploid sporophytic, and second one is the haploid gametophytic. Haploid gametophytic. Haploid gametophytic. And these two phases of the life cycle will alternate with each other, which is called as alternation of generation. I repeat, these two phases of life cycle will alternate with each other, hence the process is called as the alternation of generation. Don't worry, we are going to speak in detail about the alternation of generation in the coming chapter. Okay, so these are the characteristics of the kingdom Plantae. So how about Animalia? We all know that animals cannot prepare or synthesize their own food. So definitely they should be heterotrophs in nature. So animals are heterotrophs. These are also eukaryotic and multicellular. These are eukaryotic and multicellular, and the mode of nutrition is holozoic mode of nutrition is seen in the animals. And very distinguishing character as compared to the plants is they don't have cell wall here. Cell wall is absent. Cell wall is absent. One more important point which you have to remember here is the reproduction is by the sexual mode. Sexual mode of reproduction. Then another character which is not there in the plants and which is present in the animals is locomotion. That is, they can move from one place to another place. So these are very basic characteristics of the kingdom Animalia. So as I said, again, everything we will see in detail in the next coming chapter. Okay. Now, so we have completed 5 kingdoms, but there are some organisms which are not placed in any of these kingdoms. These 5 kingdoms are given by R.H. Whittaker, right? We call it as Whittaker 5 kingdom classification. So there are some organisms which are not, or which did not find a place in the Whittaker 5 kingdom classification. So which are those organisms? Those organisms are viruses. Those are viruses or subviral particles. Okay, viruses and subviral particles did not find a place in the Whittaker 5 kingdom classification. That is because we don't consider the viruses as truly living organisms. We will write viruses. Fine. So these did not find a place in the Whittaker classification. That is because these are not truly, I will write it bit here so that we can write subviral particles on the other side. Okay, that is because they are not truly living organisms. They are not truly living organisms. So why do we call it as not truly living organisms or partially living organisms? That is because these viruses are living only inside the host. We call the virus as a living organism only inside the host, and outside the host we call it as a, or we consider it as a non-living organism, because it is almost the crystalline form in case of outside the host. So we call it as non-living organism or a non-living object when it is outside the host. When it is inside the host, we consider it as a living organism. Okay, so who discovered viruses and who named them as viruses? It was D.J. Ivanovsky. D.J. Ivanovsky, he first studied the viruses and he named them as viruses. Fine. So he was studying the tobacco plant, and during his tobacco plant, he at that time, actually there was no idea of viruses. Everyone thought they might be some kind of bacteria, some smaller bacteria, because viruses are much more smaller than the bacteria. So they thought maybe some small bacteria are there. which are infecting the tobacco plant. But when they actually got to know that these are not bacteria, these are some other type of organisms, so it was first Ivanovsky who came up and submitted in front of the scientific community that these are something else other than bacteria, and these are called as viruses. Fine. After Ivanovsky, one more person called as Bezerink in the year 1898. So he again studied the tobacco plant or the infected tobacco plant, and he said that we will first write it. It is Bezerink. All right, Bezerink. It is EK. In the year 1898, Ivanovsky in the year 1892 and Bezerink in the year 1898. So he said that one cell which is infected by this organism can infect the another cell also. That is, there is some infectious living fluid which is present in the cell, which is contagious to other cells or which is infecting other cells also, and hence he named that fluid or that particular sample which was carrying the viruses, he called it as the contagium vivum fluidum. He called it as contagium vivum fluidum. So which means that infectious living fluid. It means infectious living fluid. Okay. Next, after Bezerink, it was after a long gap in the year 1935. Okay. In the year 1935, W.M. Stanley in the year 1935, he studied the crystalline structure of the viruses. And remember, the viruses are obligate parasites. They are obligate parasites. What does obligate means? Obligate means that they are strictly, okay, obligate means strictly. They are strict parasites. It means that they have to infect the host to survive. If they infect and they are inside the host, only then the viruses can be called as living organisms. If it does not infect and if it is outside the host, then we call it as a non-living organism. Hence, we don't call it as a true living organism, and it is not being given a place in the R.H. Whitaker's classification. Clear? Now, the viruses also have genetic material. Fine. Usually the viruses which infect the plants, okay, viruses can infect almost all the living organisms, and the one which infect the plant are mostly the RNA viruses. Plant viruses are plant viruses usually contain RNA as their genetic material, whereas animal viruses can have RNA or DNA as their genetic material. Plant viruses will have only the RNA as the genetic material. Animal viruses will have RNA as well as DNA as their genetic, RNA or DNA as their genetic material. One more group of viruses, that is the bacteriophages. Bacteriophages
phages. These are the viruses which infect the bacteria, and these usually have double-stranded DNA as their genetic material. I repeat, plant viruses have RNA as genetic material, animal viruses have RNA or DNA as genetic material. Bacteriophages are the viruses which infect the bacteria. Okay, viruses which infect bacteria are called as bacteriophages, and they have double-stranded DNA as the genetic material. Clear? Now, moving on to the structure of the virus. Usually, or we will see a structure of the bacteriophage now. It is usually, we call it as a helical shape or a polyhedral shape. Fine. So this is the head of the virus. Okay. So this is the head of the virus. Head. This is called as collar. These are the tails or tail fibers. You can take them as tail fibers. This is the genetic material. The head of the virus is called as the capsid. We call this as capsid, and this is made up of protein, or this is proteinaceous in nature, and it is made up of small units of proteins which are called as capsomeres. And genetic material can be, it might be RNA in case of plants, it might be RNA or DNA in case of animals, or it might be double-stranded DNA in case of the bacteriophage. So here we are writing a structure of the typical bacteriophage, which is helical or polyhedral in shape. Okay. So this is the collar which is holding the tail and the tail fibers, and this is the end plate. This is the end plate which fixes to the substratum or which fixes to the host easily, is the end plate of the virus. When it fixes to the host, so through this hollow space it releases the genetic material which goes inside the host and takes up the host machinery and survives as a living organism. So hope the structure is clear. Next few diseases we will see. So in case of animals as well as in the plants we will see. So first disease, a very well known disease, is the coronavirus only. So all right. So the animal diseases, it is corona or COVID-19. So we can call it as coronavirus. Fine. Then another disease is the AIDS, which is caused by HIV, human immunodeficiency virus. This virus will cause the disease AIDS. Acquired immunodeficiency syndrome is the disease or syndrome which is caused by the HIV virus. All right. Then one more example is mumps. Mumps is also caused by mumps virus only. These are few of the animal viruses or animal diseases caused by viruses. How about the plants? So one example is the mosaic virus. Okay, so various tobacco mosaic, for example, is caused by tobacco mosaic virus. Okay. Now, so we have seen the viruses, but again there are few particles or there are certain organisms which are even more smaller than viruses, and they look like they are a part of viruses, but they are not complete viruses. Try to understand, those organisms will look like they are a part of the viruses, either, see, this is a full virus, all right? Either they will be having only this protein capsid, okay? Or only genetic material is present. So they share the characteristics, or they are similar to the viruses, but they are not the complete viruses. So such particles are called as the subviral particles, all right? They are called as subviral particles, and a few such subviral particles are viroids and prions. These are very important subviral particles. So firstly, we will see viroids. Viroids and prions, okay? You have to remember this. Usually they ask it in the exams and they're very important. So what are viroids? So viroids are the subviral particles which usually infect the plants. All right, they usually infect the plants, and here we will write it. They infect plants. And how is the structure of the viroids? So virus usually don't have a complete structure. Viroids usually don't have a complete structure like viruses. They have only the genetic material. Fine. They have only the genetic material. Only genetic material. And an example to quote here is potato spindle tuber disease. Potato spindle tuber disease. So what you have to remember here is they have only genetic material. There is no protein capsid or anything at all here, and they infect only the plants. Next one is prions or prions, however you can call it as. So prions are the subviral particles which don't have genetic material. These are only a small protein particles. Like they have only genetic material here, here they have only the protein part. These are the proteins. Fine. And they infect only animals. They infect only the animals. And the best example to quote for the prion infection is bovine spongiform encephalopathy. Okay. It is bovine spongiform encephalopathy, which is also called as mad cow disease. Mad cow disease. In humans, they usually cause one very severe infection, which is called as Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. It's a neurological disease which is caused by prions or the prion protein particles, which is usually called as CJ disease. CJ disease. Okay. So these are only proteins which infect animals. These are only the genetic materials which infect the plants. So like viruses, viroids and prions, there is another organism also, or there are another group of organism which have not found the place in the R.H. Whitaker kingdom of classification. That is the lichens. We will see what are lichens here. Lichens. So lichens are some special organisms or association of the organism wherein you get to see one algae and one fungi. Right, one algae and one fungi together will make up a lichen.
So what is a lichen? Lichen is a symbiotic association of algae and fungi. I'll write it. It is a symbiotic association of algae and fungi. What is symbiotic association? Symbiotic association is a mutual relationship between two organisms wherein both are being benefited by each other. So we will see how exactly they are benefited here. So algae and fungi. So algal component is called as a phycobiont. Okay, the algae here is called as the phycobiont. This is phycobiont, and fungi here is called as mycobiont. Mycobiont, and we all know that algae is phycobiont and they are photosynthetic in nature. It means the algae will prepare food, okay, and fungi will provide the shelter as well. The benefit here is, mutual benefit here is, algae will provide, or algae will carry out photosynthesis and it produces the food, and that food is used by fungi also. So fungi is getting benefited. Fine. So how exactly algae is benefited? So what fungi will do is, fungi will provide the shelter to the algae. Okay, fungi will provide the shelter to the algae, as well as the fungi will absorb the raw materials which are required to carry out the photosynthesis in the algae. That is, it will usually withdraw, or it will absorb the water from the soil and it will provide it to the algae to carry out the photosynthesis. So algae is providing food, and this is providing the shelter as well as the raw materials which are required for the algae to carry out the photosynthesis. So algae is also benefited, fungi is also benefited, and algae is not harming the fungi, fungi is not harming the algae here. So such a relationship is called as the symbiotic association. It is a mutual relationship. Alright, so a symbiotic association of algae and fungi is called as a lichen. So remember, the lichens are very good indicators of the air pollution. So by this, we will complete the second chapter. We have studied all the five kingdoms here, as well as we have studied the organisms which are not included in those five kingdoms. So we have studied viruses, viroids, prions and lichens. All right. So plant and animalia, don't worry about it. We are going to study them in detail in the next coming chapters. Fine. So by this, we will stop the video. And in the next video, we will come up with the third chapter, that is the plantae or the plants. Okay. So study properly. Subscribe the channel. And of course, make a proper notes of everything so that it will be easy for you to study during the examinations. Okay.